Class, we started with chemistry chapter 1, chemical reactions and equations. Let's have a quick recap. So we found out that chemical reactions are associated with formation of new substances. So whenever new substances are formed, the process can be called as a chemical reaction or chemical process. Then we studied some activities where new substances are forming, and we got to know that these new substances are forming with the help of certain physical changes, like changing of color in the case of lead iodide, which was of yellow color, which formed when lead nitrate and potassium iodide was mixed, right? We also learned a new word, precipitate, over here. I hope you remember. This is just a recap of the last class. If you don't remember, look, just see the previous video, first video of this chapter all over again. Then burning of magnesium ribbon also formed ash or a grayish powder, which was magnesium oxide, a new substance, which was again tested with the help of an indicator. The red indicator turned blue, red litmus paper turned blue, which shows that the new substance is basic in nature. Okay, then we studied the addition of sodium carbonate into dilute sulfuric acid. We understood the meaning of the word dilute, sodium carbonate, which was a salt. Then we studied that there happens effervescence. What is an effervescence? Fizz, I told you. So fizz is generating, that means new substances are getting formed. And later we studied that it was carbon dioxide. Then fourth activity, we put zinc granules or zinc particles in dilute hydrochloric acid or sulfuric acid. And we understood that when we mix it, hydrogen gets formed, which burns with a pop sound. Apparatus was also studied. Okay, then after understanding that what is a chemical reaction, it always takes place with certain characteristics. We studied the characteristics in depth. The first characteristic was change in state. In case of burning candle, which is a chemical change. Change in color in case of lead iodide. Formation of precipitate, also lead iodide. There can be 1,000 other examples. For now, we'll stick to certain examples which we are just studying. Okay? Evolution of gas, zinc granules when treated with sulfuric acid or hydrochloric acid dilute. We get hydrogen, which is evolution of a gas, example of evolution of gas. Change in temperature, this was very important. I told you, quick lime, when taken in a beaker and added with water, slaked lime is formed and a lot of heat is evolved. Quick lime is calcium oxide, slaked lime is calcium hydroxide, and heat is released, that means it's an exothermic reaction. But barium hydroxide, when added to ammonium chloride, the temperature of the mixture decreases. The beaker or the test tube becomes cold. So it's an endothermic reaction where heat is absorbed. Temperature goes down. Right? So change in temperature can also be a criteria, or you can say a characteristic of chemical reaction. Great. Then we studied chemical equation, which was a statement used in chemistry to represent chemical reaction. We studied a word equation, which of the activities we did in the previous section. Lead nitrate plus potassium iodide gives lead iodide plus potassium nitrate. Magnesium plus oxygen gives magnesium oxide. So this was a word equation. Then symbol equation. In symbol equation, we use the short forms or the formulae of the compounds in the elements which are involved in the chemical reaction, right? Shorthand representation of a chemical change in terms of symbols and formulae of substances involved, right? So we studied few examples, and then we studied the steps for writing chemical equation. On left hand side you write the reactants, then you put an arrow towards the right hand side, and on the right side of the arrow you write the products. You put plus sign in between the reactants if they are one or more, and products if they are one or more, right? So this is the way you write a chemical equation. Then we studied about balancing chemical equation. Why the equation must be balanced? In order to comply with the law of conservation of mass, right? Law of conservation of matter and law of conservation of mass must be complied with. And that's why the chemical reaction, chemical equation must be balanced, right? So we studied one equation over here, which was a balanced chemical equation. Zinc plus sulfuric acid gives zinc sulfate plus hydrogen, right? And then we took an example, one more example of magnesium and oxygen, which was unbalanced, where the number of atoms of certain atom, let's say oxygen, was not equal to the number of atom of oxygen on the product side. So it's an unbalanced equation. That means some atoms got destroyed in the process of chemical reaction, which is not possible. Atoms can neither be created nor be destroyed. That was one of the universal law, universal truth, and that applies to chemical change. This universal law applies to chemical change, right? So law of conservation of mass, law of conservation of matter must be followed while writing a chemical equation. That's why chemical equation must be balanced. Unbalanced chemical equation is an equation in which the number and types of atom, not the type, number of atoms on the reactant side and the product side are not equal. And this kind of equation is also known as skeletal equation. Few more examples we studied. The balanced chemical equation also agrees with the law of conservation of mass. So total mass of the product and reactant will always be equal in a balanced chemical equation. Then these symbols of certain elements with their names, which you have studied in 9th standard, I told you to just revise them. I've also sent you one PDF in the group. Please check it. In that, there are names and symbols of elements with their valencies. And then there are chemical formulae of certain important compounds with their chemical name and common name. You have to go through them and use it as your reference. Like in the last class, we studied that calcium oxide is also known as quicklime. Right, so quicklime is its common name. Quicklime, it's a funny name. Quicklime, it has nothing to do with lime, lemon, the fruit. Okay, quicklime is a name given to calcium oxide. Calcium hydroxide is slaked lime. Right, so you should remember this, and that list has all these names. So it's good for your reference. Go through it. Right, the valencies I gave you. All the valencies, important valencies, writing the formula of a compound, which you have studied in class 9. So if somebody doesn't know this, writing the chemical formula, I yesterday showed how use crisscross, in the last class I showed how to use crisscross method to write formula of a compound. Then there are some more examples. Then we studied balancing of chemical equation, taking an example of iron plus water gives iron oxide plus hydrogen, and we studied some rules and the method of balancing in depth, right? What can be changed, what cannot be changed, everything I have discussed in detail. On top of this, I have made one more video. If you have seen that video, it's very good. If you have not seen that video, I recommend before you see this video, you must see the video of balancing chemical equation practice. Right? It is in the same playlist, the second video. Please see it. because it will give you an insight about balancing in depth. With one example, I cannot prove balancing. I cannot, explain balancing in a in-depth manner. So I've taken more than 10 examples over there in that video alone. It's a 1 hour video. More than 10 different examples are explained. And some of them are really, really tricky. I also struggled while balancing them. Of course, I don't memorize before taking your class right now. I'm just taking impromptu class, like I always do in the classroom. I don't prepare my lecture, my lesson to teach you. Right? Why I'm doing this is because I'm vulnerable that way. I know that I'm going to make some silly mistakes or I am going to get stuck, but that's okay. That is how you learn. Okay? Don't aim to become perfect the first day of learning any topic or even after 10 years of learning any topic. You have to continuously evolve. So this is my evolution. Every day I'm learning. Even while teaching you, I'm learning. And the learning will never stop. Right? Let's move to the today's part. That is a new topic for today. 11 minutes are already passed in the lecture. I've given you a recap, a good recap, in-depth recap. If you feel the need of having a more, you can say more of the recap, then just watch the video again, the previous video, and you'll have all the idea about what is the chapter. Let's go ahead. Now, chemical equations can be made more informative. How can you make a chemical equation more informative? So there are few ways. The first is stating the physical state of reactants and products by the use of certain letters, such as S. S means solid, L liquid, G gas, AQ aqueous solution or solution in water. Right? Like over here you see 3Fe bracket, they have written S means Fe, that is iron, it is in solid state, plus 4H2O. H2O is actually water, but they have written G, that means they are talking about steam over here. Gives Fe3O4, which is solid, iron oxide or rust, which is solid, plus 4H2 hydrogen, which is a gas. Right? In the next equation, they have written zinc, solid, water, sorry, H2SO4, that is sulfuric acid, in aqueous solution form. Aqueous solution is solution in water, that is dilute. Gives ZnSO4, which is an aqueous solution form, plus H2. Sometimes in the in front of H2, they also show an upward arrow like this. Upward arrow like this. Upward arrow indicates evolution of gas. Downward arrow indicates formation of precipitate. You know what is precipitate, right? Precipitate is an insoluble substance which settles down in the container, in the test tube, in the beaker. Right? Insoluble substance is precipitate. Evolution of gas. Gases are always light and they always get evolved. Right? So evolution of gas is upward arrow, liberation of gas, you can say. So let's go to the next example. Here, as you can see, they've shown an upward arrow. Here they have shown a downward arrow. That means PbI2, lead iodide, is a precipitate which gets settled. Lead iodide, you remember, right? Yellow colored PPT. The first activity which we studied, change in color. Yeah, so you can show upward and downward arrow also to make your equations more informative, right? So whenever you write an equation, always remember that you can give all this extra information to make your equation more informative, right? Okay, sometimes in the place of downward arrow, they also write PPT like this below the precipitate. That means it has settled down. Sometimes they use a different kind of arrow. A double headed arrow. What is a double headed arrow? Double headed arrow shows that the reaction is reversible. Reversible. Reversible reaction. Reversible means like here, nitrogen and hydrogen can give ammonia, but ammonia can also give hydrogen and nitrogen again by decomposing. So the reaction can take place in both directions. Right? Then you can also write DIL and CONC. DIL for dilute, dilute for DIL, and CONC for concentrated. Here it's not written, but I'm just giving you an information. Concentrated. Concentrated means less water. More chemical, less water. Concentrated. Dilute, more water, less chemical. Dilute. So you can also tell about the concentration of the substance of your chemical with the help of the extra information which you can provide, right? More informative chemical reactions. And sometimes the conditions of the reaction, such as temperature, pressure, and catalyst, are also shown above or below the arrow in the equation. For example, 2KClO3, which is a gas, potassium chlorate, potassium hyperchlorate or hypochlorate, or potassium chloride. Oh, okay. We have to check this. Let me check this and tell you the name, exact name. So it is potassium chlorate. KClO3, please remember the name. If you don't remember the name, you can write it down so that in your notebook, you can write it down right now. You can take a note so you remember later. So potassium chlorate, which is in gaseous state, gives potassium chloride plus oxygen. Potassium chloride, KCl. Okay. Potassium chlorate is gas. It gives potassium chloride, which is solid, plus oxygen, which is gas. But this reaction takes place with heat. You have to heat potassium chlorate, right? So I also am little confused about the state of potassium chloride, because when I searched it, it was a solid state. So I'm not sure, but anyways, that's not the point over here. The point is that the reactions can be made more informative by writing the conditions of the reaction, such as temperature. Now heat is given, so that's a condition in which the reaction takes place. So that's how you can make your reaction, your equation, more informative. Now next is carbon monoxide plus hydrogen gives CH3OH. This is methanol. Yes, methanol. Or it can also be written as methyl alcohol. You will study this in the last chapter of chemistry, that is carbon compounds, organic chemistry, right? Methanol or methyl alcohol, CH3OH, which is a liquid, right? So this happens in a particular conditions. What are the conditions? Condition is 340 atm pressure. Now what is this atm? Atm is a unit of pressure. Now you have studied in class 9th that the pressure, quantity pressure, has the unit Pascal. Now that is mechanical unit of pressure, Pascal, Newton per meter square, force upon area. But the unit which is used in physics and chemistry, some other aspects of physics and chemistry, mostly gases, that is atm, right? If you ask me what is the normal pressure outside the atmospheric pressure, it is 1 atm. 1 atm is normal pressure. 340 atm is very high pressure. So this 340 atm pressure is used in mixing carbon monoxide and hydrogen to give methanol or methyl alcohol, right? The next type of reaction in which the condition is shown, that is sunlight and chlorophyll, is photosynthesis. Now, sunlight and chlorophyll are
not involved in the reaction of photosynthesis, but they are present. Their present is must. Without their presence, photosynthesis cannot occur. So sunlight and chlorophyll act as catalyst in the photosynthesis reaction, right? So in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll, carbon dioxide and water gives glucose and oxygen. So what is a catalyst? Catalyst is a substance. Please note this. Catalyst is a substance which alters the rate of reaction without taking part in it. So you must be wondering why I've written everything down already. So what happened was I shot the whole video. The whole lecture was recorded for 1 hour 40 minutes, and then when I stopped the recording, the software malfunctioned. The software did not pick it up. So I just got 18 minutes of footage, and that's it. So just a moment, what is this? Yeah, I just got 18 minutes of footage and I could not work with it, so I'm shooting the whole chapter all over again. So you will see the notes already written. I have explained that already, but all in vain. Right now it's showing that it is recording, but if I stop it, somehow it's not working. I hope it does not happen again. So anyway, so what we are studying here is the chemical equations which can be made more informative with certain means. So you can state the physical states of the reactants and product, solid, liquid, gas. You can also state whether the liquid which is used is in aqueous solution form, dilute form, or concentrated form. If there is any evolution of gas, which is shown by upward arrow or downward arrow, which represents precipitation, precipitate, formation of precipitate, insoluble substance which settles down. The direction of reaction, if it is a double-headed arrow, then it is a reversible reaction. If it is a single direction arrow, then it is a non-reversible or normal reaction, right? Then the concentration, I just told you, dilute and concentrated, and conditions of the reaction, for example, temperature or heat or pressure or presence of catalyst. So this is how a reaction can be made more informative. Okay, there's one more thing, which is the production of heat or absorption of heat. So whenever heat is produced, you write plus triangle. Triangle means heat, or you write plus heat, or you write plus 572 kilojoule. What is this kilojoule? Joule is a unit of heat or energy, right? Kilojoule is also a unit of heat. So 572 kilojoule of heat is generated when water is made by the combination of hydrogen and oxygen, right? And similarly, nitrogen and oxygen, when combines, it absorbs heat. It absorbs 180 kilojoule of heat and combines and forms nitric oxide. What is NO? I told you earlier, NO is nitric oxide. Okay, I remember that. So next thing is exothermic and endothermic reaction. So it may be noted that depending upon the evolution or absorption of heat or energy, the chemical reactions are classified in two types: exothermic and endothermic. Exothermic reactions are the reactions in which heat is evolved, heat is produced. The reactants which produce on decomposition or on combination, the reactants which produce heat are said to be undergoing exothermic reaction. So exothermic reaction, if you see, the examples are burning of coal, right? Formation of water from hydrogen and oxygen, exothermic reaction. Formation of hydrogen chloride or hydrochloric acid is also exothermic. Burning of methane gas, natural gas. Methane plus oxygen gives carbon dioxide plus water plus heat. So every reaction over here, you must remember these examples, and you must also be able to write their balanced chemical equation whenever asked in exam, right? So every reaction which you see here is exothermic reaction. The decomposition of vegetable matter into compost is also an exothermic process. So one very important thing you should know, that the combustion reactions like burning of fossil fuels, for example, LPG, diesel, petrol, natural gas, kerosene, coal, burning of all these fossil fuels, also wood, are examples of exothermic reaction because they produce a lot of heat on burning, right? One more thing, respiration is also an exothermic reaction. What happens in respiration? The glucose breaks down with the help of oxygen into carbon dioxide, water, and energy. It gives out or releases energy. Respiration releases energy. So that's why respiration is an exothermic reaction because it produces energy or heat, right? So that's one small little example. Endothermic reactions are opposite of exothermic. They absorb heat. Reactants absorb heat and then the reaction proceeds. Sometimes the temperature of the reactants also goes down when the reaction proceeds. The examples of endothermic reactions are formation of nitric oxide. N2 plus O2 plus heat gives NO. Then decomposition of ammonia. You know what is ammonia? Ammonia NH3. What is ammonia? Ammonia is a gas. Have you seen or you can't see the gas, but have you smelled this gas? It has a very typical pungent smell, right? So you have smelled this. Have you traveled by local trains? Yes, you have definitely traveled by local trains. So on every station of local train station, there is a spot where this ammonia is very high. So you might be thinking, what kind of spot is this? So your train passes through the platform and then there comes this spot and you can smell this stench, very pungent smell of ammonia. Can you guess what is that location where ammonia is generated? Some people might know it, or for those who don't know it, it is the public toilet, public urinal. Right? Yuck, right? Very bad. So that smell which you get from the public toilets is the smell of ammonia. Ammonia is the major constituent of human urine. Human urine is made up of uric acid. Uric acid decomposes to give out ammonia. So in public toilets, there are no flush and all in railway toilets. So there you smell ammonia, strong smell. So that's the decomposition of ammonia is also endothermic reaction. Ammonia decomposes to give nitrogen and hydrogen. Then decomposition of water is also endothermic, and decomposition of calcium carbonate. You know what is calcium carbonate? Calcium carbonate, the common name of calcium carbonate is limestone. So I've given you that PDF in the group. You can check the name of these compounds, the common name, the chemical name, the formula, everything is there. Calcium carbonate is limestone. Limestone is also known as marble in day-to-day life. Right? When it decomposes with heat, it's an endothermic reaction. It produces calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. What is calcium oxide? It is quicklime. Quicklime is, again, I told you, calcium oxide is another name, quicklime or just lime. So that was the first part of the chapter. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to stop this video. And the remaining questions, I'm going to send it to you in the group. And you have to solve those questions. And I'm simultaneously uploading the second part of the chapter also. But let me just get over with the first part. This was the first part. The next part has types of chemical reaction, different types of chemical reaction. This I'm going to do in the next part. Okay, so see you in the next part of the video. Bye bye.